We start now our investigation of discrete optimization problems where the decision variables must be integer. In this first video, we investigate the use of binary variables that can be used in so many applications. We can model the fact that we can take an action or not, that we can put a switch to on or not, and so on. We investigate here several logical rules that can be translated into a mathematical formulation of an optimization problem. The whole idea of the use of the binary variable is that we associate the value of the variable to a logical identity. We will say that the variable x is equal to 1 if one statement is true and 0 otherwise. So the statement can be, I buy stock, I perform a given action, I put a switch to on. And if it is true, then the value of x will be 1. If it is false, the value of x will be 0. Using binary variable is a very powerful tool to translate logical conditions into mathematical formulas. The first thing that we can do is to model logical negation. So suppose that the clause P is represented by the variable x, which is 0 or 1. Non-P would be represented by 1 minus x. And we can verify this in the table on the right. So we know that if P is true, non-P is false. And if P is false, non-P is true. Now we use the definition of the logical identity. If P is true, x would be 1. And if P is false, x would be 0. Then we can calculate the value of 1 minus x. Here it is equal to 1 minus 1, it is 0. And here it is equal to 1 minus 0, which is 1. And we can verify that non-P is coded as requested. False corresponds to 0 and true corresponds to 1. The next one is a logical conjunction. Suppose that we have two clauses, P and Q, which are represented by two binary variables X and Y. We will say that the clause P and Q, the conjunction of the two, is represented by the product of X and Y. In the table, we have all possibilities. The four possible combinations for P and Q being true or false. And we know that P and Q will be true only if both P and Q are true. Everything else is false. Now the value of x, x corresponds to P, so we have 1, 1, 0, 0. And the value of y corresponds to Q, so we have 1, 0, 1, 0. We can now calculate the product of the two. Here we have 1, here we have 0, here we have 0, and here we have 0. And we can verify that this corresponds to the coding of the conjunction. Note that if x and y are both variables, this product becomes nonlinear, and we will see later on that it may be an issue. Actually, when we will use constraints, it's not necessary to multiply the two conditions. We will, because all the constraints of an optimization problem have to be verified, we can keep them separate in the formulation. However, if x is a variable and y is a data, which is constant, then we can use this formulation. The next one is the disjunction. So again, if the clause P is represented by X and clause Q is represented by Y, disjunction, which is called P or Q, is represented by the condition X, Y, Y greater or equal to 1. Let's verify that. So here the value of X corresponds to P, 1, 1, 0, 0. The value of y corresponds to q, 1, 0, 1, 0. Then we can calculate x plus y. We have 2, 1, 1, 0. So is it greater or equal to 1? Yes, 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 no. And we see that these two represent the same thing. The next one is the exclusive disjunction. We have a clause P and a clause Q. The exclusive disjunction is when one of them is true, but not both. If P is represented by the binary variable X and Q by the binary variable Y, The exclusive disjunction is modeled by the condition x plus y equals 1. And this can be verified in the table on the right. So the exclusive disjunction is true when one of the two clauses is true, but not both. When both are true, this is false. So x has a value that depends on p, y has a value that depends on q. And now we can calculate x plus y, which is 2, 1, 1, 0. Is it equal to 1? No. Yes. Yes. And no. And we can see that these two columns indeed coincide. The next one is the logical implication. We say that P implies Q if we have Q or non-P. Either Q is true or P is false. So if Q is true, the implication is true. Or when P is false. If X and Y are binary variables representing the clauses P and Q, the implication is modeled by the condition x less or equal to y. This can be verified by filling the table. So x has a value that is defined by p. Y corresponds to q. And if we have x less or equal to y, yes, no, yes, and yes. We can see that these two columns coincide, and that this inequality indeed represents the implication. Well, the next one is actually trivial. It's the equivalence that will be represented by the equality between the two binary variables. And this can be easily verified. And again, we can see that the two columns coincide. An interesting case that happens often in optimization is when one of the constraints is actually optional. We have a binary variable, let's call it z, and if z is equal to 1, the constraint f of x greater or equal to a must be verified. But if z is not equal to 1, this constraint must not be verified. A typical example is that if I want to buy a car, I need to have enough money in my bank account in order to be able to purchase it. But if I don't want to buy it, it does not matter. So here, the variable z would represent the decision to buy a car or not. If z equals 1, then I need to have this constraint that the money I have on my bank account must be greater or equal to the price of the car. But if z is equal to 0, if I don't buy the car, this constraint is irrelevant. In order to be able to model this, we need to assume that the function f that characterizes the constraint is bounded from below by a lower bound. It means that the condition fx minus l greater or equal to 0 is always true, whatever the value of x. To model the optional constraint, I will impose the following constraint: f of x greater or equal to l plus a minus l times z. Let's consider the two cases. If z equals 1, this constraint will write f of x greater or equal to l plus a minus l equals a. So if z equals 1, we have f of x greater or equal to a, which is the constraint that must be verified. Now if z equals 0, this constraint will write f of x greater or equal to l. But this is always verified because l is a lower bound on f of x. So this constraint does not mean anything. It's always verified, whatever the value of x. This is how we can achieve our result. This works well for a constraint which is greater or equal. We can do the same with constraints that are lesser or equal. For example, if I want to buy a car, I need to have at least one parking space to leave the car during the day when I'm working. If I decide not to buy the car, I don't need that. It's not necessary. We have the same configuration as before. Z is a binary variable. If Z equals to 1, the constraint must be verified. The only difference now is that the constraint is a less or equal. If Z equals 0, the constraint must not be verified. And here, in order to do that, we will need to assume that F is bounded from above. So M is an upper bound on F of X. And the constraint will be written like this. We will write F of X must be lesser or equal than A times Z plus 1 minus Z times capital M. And it can be verified again that if Z equals 1, this would write f of x less or equal to a, which is the constraint that we need to verify. If z equals 0, we have f of x less or equal to m, which is always true. This is how we get our result for the optional constraint, which is a lesser or equal inequality. And the same trick actually can be used to model disjunctive constraints. So where we have two constraints, f of x greater or equal to a, and g of x greater or equal to b, for example, and we want to impose that one of them must be verified, but not necessarily both. If I take the example of the car again, we can buy a car if either my wife has enough money on her bank account, or if I have enough money on my bank account, but not necessarily both. In order to do that, we will assume, as before, that the two functions are bounded from below, so we call LF the lower bound on F, and LG the lower bound on G. We will introduce a variable Z, which is 1 if constraint 1 must be verified, and which equals 0 if constraint 2 must be verified. And we will write the two constraints as follows. F of X will be greater or equal to L F plus A minus L F Z, and G of X greater or equal to L G plus B minus L G times 1 minus Z. So we can see if Z equals 1, here we have F of X greater or equal to A, and here we have G of X greater or equal to LG. This is always true because LG is the lower bound, and this is the constraint we want to impose. Similarly, if Z equals 0, we have F of X greater or equal to LF, and G of X greater or equal to B. This is always verified because LF is a lower bound on F, and this is the constraint that we would like to verify. The last property is extremely important when we want to keep our optimization problem linear. And we will understand why when we will look at the algorithm. Suppose that I have three binary variables, x, y, and z, and I want to impose the constraint that z is equal to x times y. We saw before that the product x times y represents the conjunction, the fact that both x and y are true. The way to model this is by including these three constraints instead, x plus y less or equal to 1 plus z, z less or equal to x, and z less or equal to y. Note that these three constraints are linear in x, y, and z. Now we need to verify that these three constraints put together indeed represent the condition that we want to verify. So we have here put all the possible combinations of values for x, y, and z, and then we can check first, if x plus y is less or equal to 1 plus z. X plus y is 2, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. 1 plus z is equal to 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1. So is this less or equal? We have yes, no. Yes, 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 and yes. Is z less or equal to x? Yes, 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 no, yes, no, and yes. And now is z less or equal to y? Yes. Yes. No. Yes. 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 No. Yes. And finally, let's check if x times y, so this would be 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Is it equal to z? This is yes. No. No. Yes. No. Yes. No. Yes. And now we can verify that the yes here correspond to 3 yes. And if you look at the no, there is at least one no in the column. So which shows that the two conditions are equivalent. A binary variable can be used to translate a logical statement. In this video, we have reviewed how to translate logical rules into mathematical formulations that can be embedded in an optimization problem.